Great. Thank you for coming. It's good. Very happy to be here. I've been looking forward to this workshop for, it's been, I don't know, a year or more since, it has kind of, in preparation for it, thinking about interpretability and what I wanted to say, it has kind of shaped, you know, some of my thinking in the last year, so that's been fun. So some of you saw a talk that I gave here in the opening tutorial sessions. I have, you know, there's some commonality, but the main message of this talk is different. But I will, there is this kind of connecting theme of simulation-based inference, so I'll talk about that some more, and then try to bring in this issues of interpretability and somehow, you know, why from a scientific point of view it's important. And what aspects of that very heavily overloaded word do we, you know, are we actually interested in? And then also kind of, I'm going to sort of frame a lot of this in the context of sort of experimental design and like the scientific method kind of at large. There we go. Now I'm having problems with the thing again. Okay. I just wanted to thank funding agencies. So a lot of the work that I'm doing is funded from the National Science Foundation, but we also had, there's a large grant from the Moore and Sloan Foundations that went to NYU, Berkeley, and the University of Washington, and that pushed on a lot of really cross-disciplinary research, and so I definitely would like to thank the foundations for that, because it's certainly influenced my a lot of my trajectory in the last few years. And in terms of people, there's a lot of people, but it's just kind of a collection of collaborators that I've been working with in the last few years, and it's roughly half physicists, half either computer scientists or machine learning researchers or statisticians or applied mathematicians, and it's been it's been very very fun. After getting tenure and finding the Higgs boson, wasn't quite sure what career was going to look like after that, but it's actually been like one of the funnest times of my academic career recently. This is from the website for this long program, and I just wanted to highlight a few things, and I did this in the last talk as well, but it goes through this overview, and I like the overview a lot, and talks about using machine learning. One point is here is either from experiments or simulations. I think it's important to keep in mind that of the talks, some things are really, you have a simulator, and you're just trying to understand what's going on inside of the simulator, and then other times you have real experimental data. There's the point that I think is easy to believe, that machine learning is allowing us to interrogate high dimensional complex data in ways that were not before possible. So that seems very natural. Then there are these other lines in here. It talks about, however, a lot of the use of machine learning and the subphysical sciences so far has been limited to low-hanging fruits, as they've mostly been focused on fitting pre-existing physical models to data. Not totally sure what was in mind with that sentence. I mean, I think lots of things could be in mind when whoever wrote that sentence originally, and I'm not going to like disagree with it strongly, but I will, there is another context in which trying to do inference in the context of a pre-existing physical model is still very, very hard, and I wouldn't characterize as low-hanging fruit. Is that your sentence?
So I wrote that.
Yeah.
What I had in mind is, but I have in mind every proposal, right? Proposal that gets funded.
Okay, perfect. Well, successful, yeah, successful.
Every year, and so it works.
No, it worked. But it is kind of useful because I think it's a. It does sound kind of right, but I think there's another way in which you'll see that a lot of the talks that we've had are like, you have like molecular dynamics or something like that. That's the model, but trying to do inference is very hard, right? So, but there's this kind of futuristic version, which is a lot of what the last workshop was about, which is about trying to sort of learn the models themselves, try to learn physical principles underlying the data, and try to automate the sort of scientific process in general. So I'm going to actually talk about that a little bit. And then there's also this part that scientists or physicists would like to have models that are physically understandable, and that certainly motivates this workshop, which is about interpretability. And it mentions some things like wanting to have like symmetry, conservation laws, symmetries, and things like that. That's one type of property you would like the models to have, but there's other notions that you would like them to have, like, so for instance, that they're interpretable in some way. So the way that I'm going to try to talk about this a little bit is sort of take a big step back and think about we have a lot of successes and a lot of things to be very proud of, but if we take a big step back and think about like the scientific process writ large, where are we? Okay, and this is like you Google scientific method, there's of the images you'll find, many of them are like really simple circles. This one I think is a little bit more interesting because it's got a little bit more going on. But But you know, think about these different steps in terms of you know, you're thinking of an interesting question, you're formulating hypotheses, developing testable predictions. Like, you know, machine learning has a pretty hard time formulating hypotheses right now, right? This is a difficult part. This is like humans are largely doing this. And actually, a lot of these, making the observations, okay, sometimes you have labs that are kind of automated and that's, you know, turns into robots or something, but oftentimes that's done by humans. A lot of what's going on here is still very much done by humans. And then, you know, I think machine learning is really happening largely in the kind of after you've gathered some data, you're helping analyze it in some way. And so, you know, I will come back to this in the end, but like part of what I want to say is that I think one of the reasons that it's important for machine learning to be interpretable is that as long as humans are, like, you know, machine learning might do much better, like black box machine learning method might do much better than humans for like one of these boxes, but if you can't interpret it, then you kind of can't continue the process, right? You need, right now, humans are sort of in charge of coming up with new hypotheses and trying to figure out what the next experiment that you're going to do to test it is, and until, you know, we have computers that can do that very well and algorithms that can do that very well, it's important for us to be able to interpret the results. So that's in some sense like the takeaway message of the talk. But this loop, there's different ways of talking about this loop. Here's one that that David Bly and company show a lot, which is this sort of box loop, where the idea is that you're sort of you have some knowledge and some questions, you're making some assumptions here written in terms of a graphical model, then you bring in some data, you discover some patterns in the data. Aji showed us very nice examples of this with, you know, like ozone and you know, climate change and you know, what the patterns were in the literature there. And then once you have that model, then you might want to sort of predict and explore in some way, criticize the model and go in some loop. And you know, in some frameworks, you can automate a little bit of this, but in the broader context, in a really open-ended sense, that's still, you know, humans are doing a lot of that. Another way that you can kind of frame like the scientific method is in this connection to reinforcement learning. So I think you've all seen the news about deep learning and deep reinforcement learning playing the game of Go at superhuman levels. This is sort of a, you know, time of training some system and how good of a Go player it is, and sort of beating the best humans and then beating the best you know, previously trained model from the DeepMind team. And you know, this is you know, definitely one of the places where deep learning does very well. And the analogy of reinforcement learning to the scientific method also makes it alluring that somehow we're going to have robot scientists out there, right? So let's just kind of dig into that a little bit. This is, you know, here's like one of the typical like reinforcement learning things you get from Google, where you have some agent that takes some action, interacts with the environment, gets some sort of reward. There's some sort of, you know, and the state gets updated, and then you sit in this loop. And so that, in this case, could be the robot playing Go, like it decides where to put a piece on the board, and you interact with the environment, which is like your opponent, and then, you know, everything and kind of sits in a loop. In a scientific setting, the way that I would say it is, if I'm a human agent trying to do experiments, I need to decide what experiment I want to perform. That's the action that I'm going to take. My interaction with the environment is like actually, you know, doing the experiment and gathering data. Once I've gathered that data, I need to interpret it, which to me is basically like doing statistical analysis. And now, and then my state gets updated, which you can think of as kind of a Bayesian update. Like I had a prior state of knowledge, I did this, and now I update my to a posterior, and then I sit in this loop, right? Okay. Now, so that's the way that that's going to be largely the way that I'm thinking of it. And so just in terms of notation, I'm going to think of sort of a forward model that's making predictions. So I have some theories, and I'm, you know, largely thinking, you know, scientific type theories, not just some kind of random black box model. So I have some scientific theory. It has some parameters of interest. That's what I'm calling theta. And based on those parameters of interest, the theory allows me to make predictions about what the data would look like. And so I'm calling the data X. Now, if I'm actually doing real experiments, then there might be things like calibration constants that aren't properly known or all sorts of other things that I don't really care about inferring, but they will change the distribution of the data. So those are these nuisance parameters I call new. And inside of my simulator, there are lots of things that are going on that I might not have access to in my actual observations. So, and those are, I'm gonna call those latent variables. So these are all these like microphysical states that are available to you in your simulator, but you don't see and real experiments. So that might be, you know, some if you're doing fluids, like you have some very fine grained simulation of what's going on, but then, you know, the observed data is just some kind of like column depth that you're measuring or something, you know, any of a number of things that might come up. So those are the latent variables Z. And now given these observed data, I want to try to do inference on, you know, mainly on the parameters of interest. And the thing that's tying everything together is some statistical model that says the probability of the data, the latents given the parameters of interest and the nuisance parameters. And if you're super duper Bayesian, a lot of times like people will call these things also latents. For me, I like, as a scientist, I kind of like to separate them, and because even if you're like very frequentist, like I don't, if the parameter of interest is like the mass of the Higgs boson, like I don't know what the mass of the Higgs boson is before I found it. I don't even know if the Higgs boson exists. It's hard, you know, I could try to come up with a prior on it. It's like but it's definitely has a different nature to it. There's not no previous data out there to help me inform what that parameter value is. But the latent variables are things that have like, in a frequentist sense, have a real, you know, sampling distribution associated to them. So the separation is more like if you want to play nicely with frequentists. But in the end, you can just put a prior on those and work in Bayesian. So, okay. So now the way that I'm going to frame this next bit is in terms of statistical decision theory. You could do it in a few different ways, but I'm just going to walk through this quickly. But so what I'm thinking of is I've got states of nature. So capital theta is like the parameter space for my parameters theta. X is the space of my possible observations, and then I also have an action space, right? So this is what I'm going to take some action, and then I have a statistical model that's saying what the distribution of the data is given the parameters. I have a prior over those parameters. And then you introduce this idea of a decision rule. This is a map that says, given some data, I'm going to take some action, right? And that action is completely arbitrary. I mean, completely abstract at this point. So it could be like claim the discovery, like I see the data, I'm going to claim a discovery or not, right? Or it could be decide to build another particle accelerator or don't, or something like that, right? Or build some other experiment. And that's actually a lot of the framing of what I'm going to be doing is this decision rule is going to be basically what experiment should I do next? You know, the action is what experiment should I do? Then I have a loss function, which takes in the value for the parameter of nature and the action that I take, and it's going to give me some sort of, you know, loss or a utility, if you want. And what's interesting there is, you know, whether or not that was a good action to take or not depends on the unknown state of nature, right? So this loss function is a little bit tricky. You can then think about that's for like a, you know, particular action. I can couple it with a decision rule and talk about the risk. So I think about, okay, well, if my data is being generated according to my statistical model, I'm going to evaluate the loss for that value of the parameter that I don't know. I'm going to use my decision rule. I'm going to stick my data into my decision rule. That's going to give me an action. I'm going to take that action. So this expectation is the risk, right? Interestingly, so this is a frequentist thing. It's a function of the unknown parameter. So you can't really optimize that because you don't know the true value of the parameters. You could search everywhere and have some kind of, you know, worst case scenario type of action. But if you're working with the risk, it's always going to be in this kind of frequentist version. If you come with a prior in hand, then I can talk about the Bayes risk, where I also take the expectation, you know, averaging over what I think states of nature might be. And at that point, then I can really like optimize over delta. Like I can think about a bunch of decision rules and find the decision rule that's going to minimize my Bayes risk. Right, but you can't do that if you don't have a prior, right? So, yeah.
Wouldn't this be the posterior?
What's it? Oh. I think, well, this expected loss is where you have a posterior. Yeah, yeah. So this is what leads to like generalized Bayes rules and things like that. But I think this is the. Okay. So here's just some setup, and it's just kind of important to remember like where the prior comes in and whichever. But okay, the main point here is that there's a very solid, clear like statistical framework, and this is very similar to like what's going on in RL and things. Okay, so what is the thing that I want to optimize? Well, it could be, you know, like the GDP of the country or like my personal happiness or any of a number of things that I want to, is my utility that I'd like to optimize. If you're thinking of it in a very like scientific way, maybe what you want to do, this would be like if, you know, experiments were free and things like that, maybe what you would want to do is choose the experiment that's going to lead to the biggest change from your prior distribution on the parameter to your posterior. Hopefully if you get some data that's informative, the posterior is going to shrink a lot. And so the entropy here is going to be a lot smaller than what you had at the beginning. So this change in entropy is like a measure of how much you learned. And so so I'm going to like scan over all the experiments that I might do and try to find the one that's going to, that an expectation, assuming my model, is going to maximize the expected information gain. Is that fine? Okay, so this is gonna be the setup. Again, the only way that I could do this is if I have a model for what the data would look like, right? You can't answer this question ahead of time. You don't have the data yet, right? You're trying to imagine experiments that you could do, and if you were to do them, you need to be able to predict what the data would look like under, you know, if you make some assumption about what the parameters of nature are. And so this already really goes back to a lot of the themes in Yuta Perl's talk, right? This is not something you can answer if you just know a big joint distribution over the data, right? This is a question of what would the data look like if I were to perform the following experiment, right? So this requires like a causal generative model for what's going on. And like, so that's one of the things that somehow as a physicist, I both knew and was completely not aware of simultaneously, is that like physical theories are not, like I kind of thought about Feynman diagrams as like a distribution, just encoding a distribution over the data, and they do, but they encode a distribution over the data coupled with whatever experiment that I'm doing, right? So they're a much more powerful thing. The theories in general, they make predictions in a context, and figuring out how to like tie those two things together is interesting, but they're really all the theories are like basically causal. Okay, so if this is my goal, this is what I want to optimize, say for the purpose of this talk, you could pick something else, but. Then this is kind of my like scientific loop and sort of workflow land, right? So I'm going to start off with some experimental configuration. I'm going to perform an experiment. So that's this block is doing an experiment. I get some observed data. I'm going to put it into my inference machine. That's going to take the data and my prior, do Bayes and stick out a posterior, okay? And then I'm going to, so now I have a new posterior, and then I want to figure out what experiment to do next. So at this point, I need to go like make proposals over possible experiments that I might do, evaluate the expected information gain for each of them, keep doing that until some sort of convergence, and I'm happy with what I think is the experiment that's gonna optimize this, and then I stick it up into the loop, I have a new experimental configuration, and I sit in the loop, right? So. And then this expected information gain, block here, this one thing, what is it, right? I start off with some experimental configuration. I need to imagine what the data would look like. So I run a whole bunch of simulations. I take my simulated data instead of real data. I do Bayes stuff, I get a posterior. I calculate the information gain between the prior and my posterior. Do that many, many times with, to get an expectation and try, and then at some point, I'm happy with my expected information gain calculation. I spit it out. So this block is like what's happening just here, right? So you can just, from an engineering mindset, you can just start building all of this. And I did build all this, and I'll show you these things. But at this point, again, like Bayes just happens. And this is kind of like, you're probably just thinking symbolically Bayes' theorem here, right? But that, of course, can be a heavyweight operation sometimes. Okay, so. All right, now let's talk about the ingredients to do this. So if I want to do this argmax, okay, I'm sorry, this is a break in notation because I borrowed a slide from Dustin. X here is really meant to be like the deltas, like what experiment am I going to do next? Or I guess A, actually the action that I'm gonna take. So I wanna do this maximization. That can be very costly. So I'm gonna bring together these sort of three ideas in this next little bit. So one is the idea of active learning. Another one is like a kind of engineering issue, which is about reproducible workflows or reusable workflows. And then later we'll get to simulation-based or likelihood-free inference engines. Okay, so the first part, let's talk about active learning. Some other people have talked about this in previous talks, so I'm gonna go quickly. But the basic idea is this axis is supposed to be what experiment I might do. And this vertical axis is the expected information gain. I don't know this function ahead of time, so I have to go calculate it, which is expensive. So these red dots are supposed to be like evaluations of this unknown function, and the red dotted line is supposed to be like the true underlying function that I don't know. Okay, and it's noisy. I get noisy estimates. So I go evaluate it a few times, and then I can use a Gaussian process to try to approximate what this underlying true unknown function is. And so that's the dotted green line. Based on these data points, you know, it basically goes through the red data points. It has uncertainty bands around it. So between the points that I've evaluated it, the uncertainty is large. And now I need to figure out, I'm trying to maximize this function. I could just sort of go to the top of this green line. That's my best guess of the maximum of the function. But there are these other areas where I have a lot of uncertainty, right? So there's this trade-off between exploration and exploitation. And so there's various ways to deal with that. And so you pick one of the different ways of trading this off. So one of them would be basically to look at the upper confidence band, like the top of this green envelope. Yeah?
Is this confidence band just proportional to the distance away from the data points?
This is like ridge regression or Gaussian processes. So you basically imagine that there's a function. It's like there's a function here, and at every point it's like a Gaussian distribution here, but there's like a covariance between nearby points to give you smoothness. So you have to
So you
have a modeling choice, which is what level of smoothness do you think is there, and you can try to update that as you get more data. So I'm kind of sweeping that part under the rug. If you didn't assume anything, it could be anywhere. But if you think there's some smoothness, then it's going to look roughly like this. Yeah, if I do that, so here this blue curve is some kind of what's called an acquisition function, which is the trade-off between exploration and exploitation. So this is basically saying how valuable do I think it is going to be to run my simulator at all these different points. That's a cheap objective. I go optimize that thing. I find the blue point. I say I should go run my simulator there. I run my simulation there. I calculate this expected information gain. It sits somewhere on the true, this unknown red function, but now I've evaluated it. I update my Gaussian, process to this green thing, and I have a new guess, and I just keep iterating this whole process, and then at some point it basically converges, and I'm like, okay, I'm pretty sure this looks like the best guess of to optimize this function. So that was like a quick surrogate. Like I only evaluated the expensive thing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times, but then I have a pretty good guess for where the optimum is. So this is this Bayesian optimization approach. Yeah.
Presumably you can bake in the known physics of the system and the kernel structure rather than using the...
Yeah, but the known physics is complicated, right? Because the function is the expected information gain of doing like the following experiment. So it's like, it's a pretty...
Yeah, I think the Gaussian kernel basically tells that you don't know anything.
No, you put a notion of like smoothness in here. Yeah. There are other ways you can try to do this optimization. I'm just going to say, like, for the purposes of this talk, I'm going to use this Bayesian optimization. It's commonly used, but it's not super easy to get physics in here directly because you're trying to evaluate this function, which goes through an entire experimental process of Bayes theorem, and it's a pretty complicated. It's a few steps removed from the underlying physics, but okay. But you could maybe, but. Okay, so now that I have that, I've done this process, I've figured out where to run my new experiment, I'm gonna go up there, okay? Now, this is all kind of, in some sense, pretty textbook, I'm not doing anything new. But now what I wanna get to is that when I did this expected information gain calculation, how did I know what the data was gonna look like for this experiment I've never done? Right? It's because I have a theory and a simulator that can tell me, make predictions under those contexts, right? And so, now, separately, when I'm doing Bayes' theorem, what is the likelihood function that I'm using to do Bayes' theorem? Like, I didn't specify that yet, right? So normally, in the scientific process, when you get data and you go to analyze the data, it's like there's some, it's whatever the norms of your field is about how you analyze your data. You get the data, you pre-process, you have some analysis pipeline that you apply to the data to get results out. And usually, you don't use the simulator when you do, like, directly when you do that, right? So the point I want to make here is that the simulator is giving you a probability distribution over the data. So like, why don't you not use the simulator as like the likelihood function part, like the statistical model in this whole story, right? So it seems like that would be the cleanest thing to do. So here's an example of like, here's LHC data. I have simulator, this is a real data event that's being visualized, but I have simulators that work at the same granularity and they're very, very high fidelity. And I use those simulators to try to design the experiments. Like when we were designing the LHC, we used those simulations to try to optimize what we would do, but we don't kind of directly use them when we analyze the data to get like in like the kind of Bayes' theorem way. So here's just kind of a walkthrough of some of the ingredients of like particle physics simulator. This is the standard model of particle physics that, you know, that tells you about how like electrons and photons and quarks and gluons and all these things interact. That's the whole theory. You know, you can write it on a coffee mug. It takes a little bit of time to figure out how to like turn that theory and turn that crank to make predictions, but you know, that's like something that graduate students learn how to do. Like a perturbative expansion of this this Lagrangian leads can be represented pictorially as these Feynman diagrams, which I'm sure you've probably seen at some time. So this is like gluons from a proton interacting, making a Higgs boson and a top quark decays into a W and two Bs, you know, like, okay. So this pictorial form is encoding something like 27 dimensional joint distribution, and you can calculate it with a pencil and paper, okay? After that stage though, there's another process where these quarks and gluons radiate, you know, that's the blue stuff, they radiate a bunch of things. And there's some kind of rule for like what happens locally, but it's a very complicated process at that point. So you have to put it on a computer. And also there's a regime where we can't really calculate it first principles anymore. So there's like some approximations that happen. And then there's another process that happens, which is whatever related to some property of the strong force, which is where quarks and gluons combine to make things like protons and, you know, and neutrons and pions and stuff like that. And the theory is not calculable there. Like no one knows how to do that. But we assume this is like universal physics and we measure it in other experiments. So at this point in the simulation, it's literally like a lookup table from past experimental data. Okay. So you go from pencil and paper to a phenomenological model to like really a completely data-driven thing, and they're all kind of grafted onto each other. And then after that, these dark green circles are like physical, meaningful, stable particles flying off into the detector. And then they run into our gargantuan detectors. And they're like bending in magnetic fields. We use like Runge-Kutta to forward integrate. And then they start hitting material. And they're ionizing. And we're tracking particles through individual atoms. And they're ionizing and having nuclear interactions and all sorts of stuff. And they lead to this big, crazy shower. And then we model the electronics readout. So there's about 100 million electronic readouts in one of these collisions. So it takes about 10 minutes to run the whole process for one collision. And the real collisions are happening 40 million times a second. Okay, so like it's a triumph that we're able to do it, but it's like obviously it's awkward, you know, it's hard to work with. But conceptually, this, for instance, if you just focus on the detector simulation, what is it? It's encoding a probability of the detector response given these incoming particles, right? If I took the same incoming particles and I simulated the detector again, I would get a different answer, right? So it's a stochastic probability model. I can't write it down. Like to know the probability that a certain one of these, you know, sensors has like a certain amount of energy in it, I would have to integrate over like kajillions of possible histories that would lead to that. And so that's like becomes we can sample it with Monte Carlo, but we can't calculate it exactly. And so that means that this thing has an intractable likelihood. Okay. So another kind of easier example to like imagine than particle physics is this one. So this is like a Galton board. And you know, you flip the thing over, the balls come down. You see nice central limit theorem. If I asked you what distribution do you think it is, like some people would probably say Gaussian, but it's like discrete, so it's not quite a Gaussian. The balls are basically going left or right each time, right? And there's I think 12 rows here, so maybe it's a binomial distribution, and you know, hopefully it's kind of balanced, so it's like a binomial with, you know, probability 50% and 12 rows. That would be my guess for what this distribution is. Here's the closed form for the binomial distribution. Here I'm thinking theta is like if all the pins were biased slightly to the left or to the right instead of all being like right in the middle. But so imagine that they're like that, and I wanted to infer, you know, this value of theta, like if they're slightly biased to the left or to the right, you know, here's a probability model, I could collect my data and I could do inference. So I went to teach an undergraduate course about the binomial distribution. I took this video for that course, and then I realized that you know, I overlaid the binomial distribution, and it's like three times narrower than this. And I was like, oh wait, it's not the, and I was confused, and I was supposed to teach in 15 minutes, so it was like, you know, what do you do? So like, uh-oh, right? So I took a close-up video of it after, you know, teaching, and here it is in slow motion. So look at these, like, look at them bouncing around. Like, it's definitely not like going left, right, left, right, left, right. You know, it's way more complicated. And so I have no idea what this distribution is, right? But the important thing is that it's very easy to come up with very expressive models to describe what's going on. They're running into each other, there's elasticity, et cetera. So I asked Gunius if he could help me out, and he used his Python physics simulator and wrote a little probabilistic program. It's dropping these little balls, they're running into each other. It looks pretty, qualitatively, it's like doing what you want, right? You can tune the parameters to make it look like the right thing, but this is kind of my point is that the simulators are super expressive, but they're very hard to work with in terms of doing inference, right? So, and so that leads to problems. And so if we think about these kinds of situations, here's some more elaborate thing where I move all the pins in some weird way. But the point is that the symbolically, the probability that you land in some bin given theta is this integral. And in the binomial situation, you can just do that summation explicitly by just combinatoric things and just simple math tricks. But if they're all in random places, you can't simplify it, right? You have to literally integrate. And the number of choices there grows, combinatorially. And so this becomes an intractable integral, and you're not going to actually have an explicit formula here to minimize, right? So, or to a likelihood function to optimize. Okay, so this is this kind of what I mean by simulation-based inference, or what's sometimes called likelihood-free inference. You have a model, you can sample from it, but you can't evaluate the likelihood because it's intractable. And interestingly, all the stuff inside, has all your physics knowledge going on. So in the point of view of I want to be interpretable, I would like to work with this thing. Instead of trying to figure out how to put my physics knowledge into a neural network, I would like to just work with my simulators that already have all my physics knowledge in them, right? Okay, and so then once I get the data, I would like to try to invert this thing, it's like an inverse problem, and try to do this inference, okay? And they happen everywhere. So this is, the Ising model. You have a very simple Hamiltonian, which basically dictates the probabilities, but the patterns that you get out of the Ising model can be, pretty complicated. Field theory for lattice QCD, here's some animation of, taking slices through, space-time. So it's you see the quantum fields fluctuating. This is why protons have mass and things like that. So we have all these theories. Here's, epidemiology. It's very easy to come up with a very convincing model for what happens for individuals and how they spread disease around and tie that to actual population data. You can model this till your heart's content, right? So, and I think what's important, and this has come up, we've seen tons of examples this week, but it's important to keep kind of a taxonomy of the different types of simulators in your mind. So one of that, some are deterministic, so things like fluid mechanics or real quantum state evolution or ODE, PDE type models. They're usually differentiable, or at least in principle. Then there are others that are more stochastic, like these statistical physics type of models, like the Ising model or the particle scattering processes that I showed you. Oftentimes there's non-differentiable elements in them because there's some kind of control flow in the simulator, which makes them difficult and you can't backprop through them. And then you may or may not have measurement noise. It may be that you're kind of thinking that you're observing the system directly and it's more of a theoretical problem, or you have you're more of an experimentalist and you have some noise model involved as well. So, so I'm going to pick up a little bit. So there's been a lot of work in terms of these different likelihood-free techniques. So approximate Bayesian computation is became somewhat synonymous with likelihood-free inference for a while because it was just a technique that people used a lot. I'm going to maybe go kind of quickly over how it works, but basically you generate samples from your simulator, you get some data, and then you basically look to see, is the data from my simulator really close to my observed data within some epsilon ball? And if you want your epsilon ball to be really small, that will give you more accurate inference, but it makes it very unlikely that you're going to generate some data that just happens to look like your data. And as you make this epsilon ball bigger, the inference loses quality. And you also need whatever this notion of distance is, right? So usually the way that that's done is that you come up with some summary statistics on the data. You try to boil the complicated data down to one or two simple summary statistics and take a Euclidean distance or something. But that's lots of ad hoc elements to it, right? And so there are just these points that when the data is high dimensional, this is not going to work very well. You need these, performance of this thing depends very much on finding good summary statistics. And if you don't know them, that's hard, right? If you want to automate science, you would like to get rid of this step, right? So what's happened recently is with the deep learning is there's been an enormous push in all sorts of different techniques that are relevant for this problem. So here's this workshop on implicit models. These are these ones that have that you can simulate from, but you can't evaluate the likelihood. It talks about several real world phenomena being best described by simulators. So this is what we're talking about. And the things, the kind of hot topics in machine learning include things like GANs, variational inference that Aji was telling us about, approximate Bayesian computation that I was just mentioning, and things that have to do with two-sample testing and et cetera, et cetera. So I'll say a little bit about that in a second. But there's now a huge amount of literature in the machine learning community that's relevant for this problem, and it's a great opportunity. So if we go back to this big scientific workflow picture where we previously had run Bayes, now you realize how difficult that is, right? I have a simulator. I don't just run Bayes because I don't have the likelihood function. So I have to do something else. So that's going to, the Bayes theorem thing is going to turn into some kind of likelihood-free inference engine where the simulator is going to be used again. You're going to have to run the simulator a bunch of times to basically, so you're going to get some data in and you have a prior, but you don't just evaluate, you don't just do Bayes, you have to run the simulator a bunch of times to try to estimate the likelihood, and there's going to be there's various ways to do this, and then you get a posterior out. But the thing that I want you to kind of keep in mind is look at all the places the simulator is being used, right? So you have your actual experiment. When you go to do your original posterior inference, you're using the simulator a bunch of times. Then you want to go optimize the new experiment, you're using the simulator a bunch of times. And then when you want to do inference to get the expected information gain, you have an inner loop where you're using the simulator a bunch of times, right? So if you had some kind of measure of complexity for this step, it's squared, cubed, it's happening a lot. So one of the points that I kind of want to make here is this kind of this reality check of, if we wanted to say, even in the simple case where we're not trying to learn the laws of physics, if I come with the laws of physics encoded in a simulator, and I say just do this kind of a scientific loop with a set experimental protocol, so it's not like the open world of possible experiments you might do, it's you have a set experimental protocol and you just want to optimize it, it becomes incredibly computationally intensive. And so the idea that we're going to and that's before you have people coming up with what experiment, the hypothesis generation part of it, it's before all these other aspects which are even sort of harder problems from an intellectual point of view. So this is supposed to be kind of a reality check of how hard it is going to be to automate science. But at the same time, if you wanted to, these are the things that we're going to have to pass through. These are the obstacles we're going to have to solve. Okay, so I've talked about simulation-based inference or likelihood-free inference. I talked about active learning and black box optimization. Let me say just a word about reusable workflows. So if you really want to do this, because doing Bayes requires running your simulator, you're going to need to package up the simulator. And a lot of simulation code that's done by scientists has a lot of baggage, and it's not so easy to do. So we worked on basically building a kind of a system. It was motivated by some particle physics problems originally, but we abstracted it. So you have a workflow that describes whatever your analysis pipeline is or your simulation pipeline. We can containerize everything with Docker or Singularity, and then we can read these workflows and deploy them on the cloud or on your HPC systems and run them. And so here's an example of taking some particle physics simulator where we containerized everything, and we basically give it an API, and it's just go run the simulation with these settings, give me back some data, and we can deploy it on the cloud or whatever. And this formula is a formula that you would a graduate student would study at some point in particle physics, which says that, so this is some example that I'll use where I want to measure this one particular parameter in the standard model, which talks about how the photon and the Z boson interfere with each other. It's called the Weinberg angle. So that's my one parameter theta I would like to measure. And I'm going to set up an experiment where I have two parameters that I can adjust. One is when I collide my beams, what's the energy of the beams? And the other thing is if the beams are polarized or not. Okay, so I have two knobs in my experiment, and I have one parameter I'm trying to measure. I containerize the simulation, put it in this thing, okay, and I can run workflows and all these kinds of things, make plots, but I hook it up to this likelihood-free inference engine, and I run it many times. And so at the end, this is what I get. this is like one. This is the center of mass energy, like the beam energy of the particles, and this is the expected information gain. And what you see is that there's two values where the expected information gain is high, and then there's a dip in the middle where it's low. And so basically, if you're going to do this, you would like to run your experiment kind of either over here or over here, right? And then you do that, and you iterate. So we were able to kind of close the loop with just purely simulation-based inference. And what's interesting is in this plot, this is the standard classical physics plot for the same thing that says that as I scan the energy of my beams, this is some kind of the summary statistic that a physicist would use their insight to plot. And what you see is they're essentially driving through a resonance, and like just below or just above the resonance, you're sensitive to this interference thing, and right on the resonance, it disappears. So that's why you don't learn anything right on resonance, but just above or below, you do. So like it completely makes physical sense, but it didn't know this. Like humans did this, and the other one is like completely automated, right? Okay. So great. So in some sense, it's nice. It works. I put this out like a little bit ago. It's not published. It's just like a GitHub repository. Danilo Resende of sort of VAE fame saw it and liked it. And so it made me feel good. But at the same time, like I think the real message I have here is the reality check is that this was hard enough in this very simple problem where everything is specified, right? Like you know what kind of experiment you want to do. You have the simulator. You're not trying to learn laws of physics. You're not trying to figure out hypothesis generation of what you should do next, and it's still very hard. Okay, so then if you keep in the back of your mind, like, okay, if this is what I want to do, like, and I want to speed this whole thing up, this is where it becomes very clear that the whatever this inference engine is, you're going to want it to be amortized. You're going to want to run those simulations and be able to reuse them as many times as possible. Aji also mentioned this idea of amortized inference. So this is it also pops up in likelihood-free inference. So the ABC type of approaches are not amortized. Every time you want to do inference, you run your simulator, and every time the data changes, you just throw everything away and you start up again trying to estimate the posterior. So you don't want to do that. You want it to be as sample efficient as possible so that you can learn this posterior by running the simulation as few times as possible. And it's not hard to imagine that you're going to want some kind of hierarchy of different types of surrogate models or approximations along the way. And then in terms of, I didn't really talk much about approaches, but you know, there's approximate Bayesian computation. There's another approach where you use the simulator really efficiently, which is what Gunius was talking about with probabilistic programming. So the idea is instead of just running the simulator and hoping it looks like your data, you do some fancy important sampling where you reach into your simulator and you try to make it, you know, steer it towards the data that you got. But this was still very heavy. You know, we weren't using supercomputers and things for doing this. And it's so in one sense, it's like, you know, very impressive. It also is, again, a reality check that this is going to be hard. The other approach is where you don't use the simulator directly, but you try to learn the simulator using things like deep learning. So this is where topics like GANs and VAEs, likelihood ratios from classifiers, normalizing flows, autoregressive models, and things like that come up. So I don't have a lot of time. I'll just mention that in the classifier picture, if you go back to like one thing deep learning is very good at is like the cats versus dogs, right? So I've got red dots and blue dots. This is the space of my data, and I would like to learn how to classify them, right? Now, in classical statistics, the optimal thing you would do would be to have the likelihood ratio for the data under the two hypotheses. But I can't evaluate this likelihood ratio because this is an intractable quantity. But I can, you know, if I could set up this loss function and evaluate this functional and try to find the function s, which minimizes this particular squared loss, the function that, you know, extremizes this is this function right here. This is the Bayes optimal classifier, and this is one-to-one with that. And so I can't do this either, but I can approximate these integrals with samples, right? So I can approximate this with samples as a typical squared loss, and when I, you know, and then I stick in, you know, a machine learning, classifier or something to a neural network to parameterize the functions, and I approximate this well, and this is one-to-one with the likelihood ratio, and if I can estimate the likelihood ratio, I can start to do inference. And that's just discrete hypothesis testing, but I can now lift this to a parametric setting. So instead of thinking, it's sort of like in the GAN, you have like the real data, like the discriminator is trying to tell the difference between between the real data and the generator. Those are like two hypotheses. And then you turn it into something like a likelihood ratio. Here, I'm going to lift, instead of it being two discrete hypotheses, to any 2 points in my parameter space. I'm going to pick 2 points in my parameter space, generate data from them, train a classifier to tell the difference between them, and try to make a neural network that has as arguments the data and the two values of the parameters that I want to compare. And if I can learn this function, then I can do inference. So that was one approach that we did. So this is kind of schematically, your own simulator, learn approximation of the likelihood ratio, do inference. Right now, the theory for like the two different, it's really a two-stage process. There's a theory for how to learn the like discriminative classifiers, and then there's a theory for doing inference. You would really like to treat them together and have something about how do I be sample efficient for the two things together. And then recently we realized we don't have to just work with samples. When we have the simulator, we can reach inside and dig out some more information and augment the data. And so I'll just try to say this super quickly. So if I go back to this, here's an example of two different ways the balls go through my Galton board and they land in the same place. I don't know, I can't do this intractable integral, but if I hold that path through the simulator fixed and I change the parameters, I can say how much more or less likely is that particular trajectory to be, as I change them. So if I think of it, joint on the latent variables and the observables, I can get out these likelihood ratios, and I can also get out the joint score, which is like the derivative of the log likelihood ratio, but where you keep the latent trajectory through the simulator fixed. And when you do that, now this is extra information you get out, but it's real valued, right? So before I was doing like, I had two values of my parameters, and my classifier was labeled like 0 and 1, like for like cats and dogs, and I was trying to learn this red function by basically a tug of war between the green dots and the blue dots. But now I have this real valued information that I can just regress on. It's going to be a much easier problem. And so here's just some picture in terms of sample efficiency. So this is how well we're estimating the likelihood. And then this is the training set size. And this is a log scale. And you see that the typical thing where you just have samples takes something like 10 million events before you start to do pretty well. And with this augmented data, we can do as well or better with like a few thousand events. So it's like three orders of magnitude more, that's going to be problem dependent. But for our problem, it required three orders of magnitude less samples. Okay, so two quick examples of this, one was a particle physics problem where it's had to do with the Higgs boson and studying the Higgs boson. There's new physics going on at these spots. They have some parameters. And so here's, for instance, this parameter. This is a log likelihood curve. And using these kinds of fancy things where we're working with a 42-dimensional version of the data, not crazy high dimensional, but pretty high dimensional, we're able to extract more out of the data. And it's like doubling the LHC data set for what's a flagship measurement at the LHC. So in terms of like the improvement in sensitivity. And we've recently applied this to strong gravitational lensing. So there's like a big galaxy and it's warping some picture of a galaxy behind it through gravitational lensing. And what we're looking for is actually not the bulk properties of the lens, but the fact that there might be little clumps of dark matter, little subhalos, those are the little blue dots, that are slightly distorting that ring. And what we want to infer, and the number of them, it's like a Poisson point process, so there's something non-differentiable going on. But the distribution of where they are is parameterized, and I want to do inference on those parameters. And so anyways, you can go through this, you can generate, you have a forward model for what's going on, you use a ConvNet, you do this likelihood ratio trick and this augmented data, and then we come up with an amortized system that you can basically just feed in new images and then update your posterior like in real time, and then be able to put constraints on these quantities that will tell you something about the particle nature of dark matter. So that seems pretty cool. So I don't have time to go through the other slides that I want. I just want to go to. I was going to say some things about these like autoregressive models and things. There is going to be a discussion later today, I think, about these flows, which are like a different way to try to do density estimation and high dimensions. There's been a ton of activity. This also connects to the talks that we had before about thinking about PDEs and things like invertible resonets and things like that. So there's now all of that literature is being brought to bear on these problems about being able to do density estimation in high dimensions. There's also some work from from Frank and Jonas that's very nice about these gauge equivariant flows. So this is just a very active area, and is an area where there have been a lot of discussions at IPAM, but maybe not explicitly in this context, but it's certainly all very relevant. We've extended these to like quantum mechanical systems. There were the points that I wanted to make about kind of causation and correlation. I think I already kind of made those points earlier, but I was very happy that we had Udaya Pearl there at our workshop. And then there were things that I was going to say, but ran out of time in terms of just how you try to put an inductive bias on the models. Because what I focused on was what's the loss function that you use to try to train these things? I didn't say anything about the actual architectures. So there's all sorts of ideas about inductive bias, compositionality, separation of scales. Peter, I wanted to highlight because I think a lot of the work that he's doing with graph networks and things like that are really like very influential for me in terms of how to how to incorporate physics knowledge into these models. And then I'll just say this a little bit at the very end is that. I think that basically before we're going to try to discover new laws of physics, the more practical starting point is like, can we start with a simulator and see that we can rediscover and pull out the known laws of physics in those simulators where there's clear ground truth? And I think that's going to be hard enough, but it's possible, and it's like a nearer term goal. And it's just very important to keep in mind that these simulators have causal structure, and that when you have the simulator, you can go do interventions on them, and then you can actually start to do the higher level of things that go beyond association to like real, how am I going to design experiments that are going to test the properties of the model because I have some causal structure in my simulator. And I think that this is like something that in the not too distant future is something we could start to automate. And then I think, in the end, the main point in terms of interpretability is that right now the humans are in charge of a lot of the hard work, and that's why it's important for us to be able to be able to interpret those results, because otherwise we kind of can't close this bigger scientific loop. And until we're able to solve these other issues about hypothesis generation and things like that, it's going to be important for us to be able to interpret the machine learning models. Okay, thank you.